Hello, and thank you for joining me today for Real Estate, Religion, and You. My name is Dr. Sylvia Black, licensed real estate broker with affordable homes and apartments. I'm licensed to preach and I'm ordained as a minister, and I have my PhD in sacred biblical studies. And I'd like to thank you for joining me today for Real Estate, Religion, and You, which airs every Wednesday right here on Time Warner Public Access TV Channel 20, Wednesdays 6:30 to 7 p.m., and Saturdays from 12:30 to 1 p.m. in the afternoon. And I'd like to thank you for joining me today. Now today I'd like to talk to you on a continued basis of my book. I got to get the new cover, which is entitled The Champion in You, Win the Battle and the War Against Your Giants. Win the Battle and the War Against Your Giants. And this book will be available April 1st on my website at Books Galore and More. You can also obtain a copy from me directly if you'd like to email me or visit my YouTube address at sblack3001 or Highway to Heaven Church, and you can respond to a message, and or you can email me at sblack3001@gmail.com, and I'll get you deliver a copy. And thank you for joining. You can also hit me up on Facebook. You can hit me up on LinkedIn and a couple of other social media where you'll find me. And I am the author of this book, The Champion in You, Win the War and the Battle Against Your Giants. How many of you know you can win the war, but you can lose the battle? Or you can win the battle and still lose the war. Okay, but we're going to win the battle and the war against the giants. Now, I hope you enjoyed my message that I talked to you last week in reference to contemplating suicide. And today we're going to talk about some more encouraging stuff that's also in the book. And it's going to be centered around the promises of God. But we're going to talk about a little bit about Paul or Saul. And we're going to talk a little bit about his experiences and how his life relates to the promises that God gives us. Now, giants are placed in our lives by God to move us into our divine and perfect future by bringing a series of events in our lives that appear as if all hell is breaking loose, and using those same events to uplift us and bring us out rather than to destroy us. God allows these events to happen to us to move us into our next level of anointing and for our divine and perfect future, not to hurt us. Although it may seem like a lot of events that go on are actually meant to hurt us. And soon I'm going to be able to share a testimony with you about what has happened to me, one of the most profound, well, not really more profound, but it seemed like a profound experience because it appeared to be a giant in my life. And I'm going to talk to you about how God helped me to overcome that, both physically as well as mentally and spiritually and financially. Okay? God is using our giants to put a thorn in our flesh, among other things, and to move us out of our comfortable situation and to move us closer to Him. You know, how many of y'all know that sometimes you get in a comfortable situation, you get, you know, all comfortable and all cozy, you know, doing the same ritual every day, getting up, going to work, you know, coming home, picking up the kids, you know, getting dressed for bed, doing what you do, cooking dinner, going to bed. You get involved in the same routine every day, and then you wonder why you're unhappy. Well, sometimes God uses giants to put thorns in our flesh, so to make us uncomfortable, to realize, hey, wait a minute, now let me think twice, you know, use some analytical thinking. Although a lot of times we can't always use logic when it comes to, you know, figuring out what God is up to, but you do have to try to figure things out. You know, you have to try to analyze it. You weigh it on the spiritual side, and then you weigh it on the physical side, and you say, wait a minute, now let me see what, you know, what's going on here. You know what I mean? Let me go back maybe a week or so and see what have I been involved in. I've been asking God for this, and, you know, I'm on this job now, and I'm unhappy, and blah, blah, blah. And so maybe God is trying to do this, or maybe God is trying to do that, you know. And then you talk to Him, and you ask Him, you know, God, what, you know, is this, you know, this mess that's happening in my life, what is the reason for it? What's the purpose of it, you know? And He'll reveal it to you. God uses our giants as tests, temptations, trials, tribulations, etc., okay, to test us and put us in a position closer to Him so that we can also receive the blessings that He has promised us and the blessings that we've been praying for. You know, a lot of times communication level is not open, you know. You pray to God, but then the other level of communication is not there. I remember I was at one job interview and excuse me, and I had told the guy, he asked me, he says, I forgot what the exact question was, but he says something about what have I improved in, what have something that I have actually overcome. And I told him, I said, I've developed excellent listening skills as a result of, you know, my job, you know. And he's like looking at me all strange. But the reality of it is what I was meaning, you know, yes, I've developed listening skills in terms of I can listen to you with my ear. I've always been listening to you. I've always been hearing you, you know, but I haven't actually been listening to you. See, there's a difference. So now he has to use a series of giants in our lives to sort of bring about a greater good. So now you got to put you in a quiet place. You know, you say, oh, you know, now you're afflicted. You're in the hospital. You're sick or whatever. Now you're laying down. Now you have time to think. You know, when you lay down at night and when you dream, you know, sometimes he has to get across to us in that respect, you know. But it's not easy when you're going through, you know, to go through. If you take responsibility, however, for your actions, we can see the sun through the tears. And we can see the light at the end of the tunnel, as it has been said. Knowing that as a child of God, bad things are going to happen. Okay, but God is in full control, and we have to remember that. And he's doing it because our biological, a natural, or extended mom and dad didn't do it. So he has to. You know, giants are God's way of teaching us, training us. He's training us to walk on water, so to speak. He's training us to have the peace that surpasses all understanding when all hell is breaking loose. He's training us to have a faith in him, even when the situation and circumstances look helpless and hopeless, okay? He's giving us the victory over our giants way before the battle has even been won, even when it looks like our giants have defeated us. And I realized that as a result of this last battle that I've been going through. He's giving us courage and strength when we are weak. He's encouraging us when we are at our lowest common denominator. Okay? And keeping us from actually going over, you know, committing suicide, I should say. He's blessing us when our giants are cursing us. However, it's not going to, he's not going to put more on us than we can bear. Okay, although it may seem unbearable, it won't be. God gives us the strength and the ability to handle everything. Okay, but he has to put us to the test. And we have to be tested, tempted, and we have to go through the trials, tribulations, and be persecuted. These tests and trials, as I said before, and tribulations and persecution are only meant to make us stronger, not weaker. Trials and tribulations are meant to give us the victory and not to defeat us. Okay, I can't reiterate that enough. They are meant to help us and to understand the mind of God and to destroy the mind of the devil and all his giants. They are meant to help us to stand up for God and not fall for the giant's tactics and tricks and schemes. Okay, nothing God does to us is meant to hurt or destroy us. God loves us and he wants the best for us. Okay, and again, I'm talking about my book. This is the old cover. The new cover will say, The Champion in You, Win the Battle and the War Against Our Giants. Okay, and it's available, it will be available on booksgaloreandmore.com. Okay, now Paul was a devout Jew and an adamant in the destruction of the young Christian community. Saul of Tarsus would become the chief author of the New Testament and one of the first international missionaries. He was shipwrecked 3 times, imprisoned, tortured repeatedly, escaped angry crowds in different locations, even fleeing Damascus in a basket lowered from a window in the outer wall. Saul notes that his greatest care is the daily pressure of concern for all the churches, spreading the good news of Jesus across the Roman Empire. Saul was content in all circumstances, even under those house arrests awaiting execution in Rome. And the Bible story is found in Acts 9:28. And that's a lot of times what will happen to us. You know, these are some of the trials and tribulations and the persecution that he has endured as a result of converting his life and turning it over to Christ. And that's exactly what will happen to us. But I think one of the main things that was going on here was that, first of all, he was the person who was actually persecuting the Christians. Okay? And then he turned around and actually was coming to help Christians. You know, so they probably couldn't understand it, you know, especially since they may have been not saved themselves. Okay, now before Saul became the apostle of grace, he had a dark side, as we all do, or did. Saul's early life included religious zeal, brutal violence, and relentless persecution of the early church. He was raised in the best neighborhood, went to the best schools. Saul's family were Roman citizens, but viewed Jerusalem as a truly sacred and holy city. The Torah, this is the law of Moses, written in the first 5 books of the Bible, exhibits a passionate intolerance for the Gentile nations, alleging the Gentiles practicing idolatry, okay, and other things that holds to be immoral. The Torah, which was the law of Moses, requires the Hebrews to engage in genocide and exterminate or expel the Canaanites, otherwise known as the Phoenicians, without mercy. And that's found in Deuteronomy 6 and 20, chapters 6 and 20, and forbade the Hebrews to intermarry with them or adopt their customs. It alleges that the Gentiles' barbarism would contaminate the Hebrews. Saul Capan argues that Joshua fulfilled this command. Saul went on to become a lawyer, and all signs pointed to his becoming a member of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish Supreme Court of 71 men who ruled over Jewish life and religion. Saul was zealous for the faith, for his faith, and this faith did not allow for compromise. Okay? It is this zeal that led Saul down the path to righteous extremism. In other words, he did his job well. Okay? He persecuted the Christians with zeal and without compromise. Okay, there was no turning back. He did it until the job was done and complete. But when he turned around and went from his wicked ways and he began to serve Christ, he did that with just as much zeal. Okay, and it was an extremism. In other words, he went to extremes to get the job done. Now, because of his extremism, prejudice, discrimination, Saul might have been present at the ritual at the trial of Stephen. Okay, and also when Peter delivered his defense, and when Saul heard Gamaliel also in the presence when he delivered his message. From that moment on, Saul became even more determined to extradite Christians as he watched the Sanhedrin flog Peter and the others. You know, Saul became more ruthless in his pursuit of Christians as he believed he was doing it in the name of God. Arguably, there is no one more frightening and more vicious than a religious terrorist, especially when he believes that he is doing the will of the Lord by killing innocent people. This is exactly what Saul of Tarsus was, a religious terrorist. Acts 8 and 3 states that he began ravaging the church, entering house after house, and dragging off men and women. He would put them in prison, all because they served Jesus Christ. Now, Saul was going to Damascus this particular day to bring a bunch of Christians back to imprison them. He was going out of his way now. He's going out of his territory. Saul was knocked down off a horse, and when he got up off that horse and he opened his eyes, he still couldn't see. He was blinded on the road to Damascus. Saul also addresses Jesus by his name, okay, at this particular moment. He knew who Jesus was. Now here Saul is meeting with Jesus after having witnessed his crucifixion. Saul pretty obviously thought that there was no one to stop him because Jesus was crucified now, you know, and he was dead. This is what he was thinking. So Saul figured that he could do what he wanted to do. So how many of y'all know that one encounter with Jesus and that changes your life forever? Okay? That's what happened with Saul. This one time he had an encounter with Jesus face to face after having thought he was dead. To his surprise, what? You're alive. Okay? And his life was transformed instantly. Not only was Saul's life changed by the name, not only was his life changed, but his name was also changed. It was changed to Paul. The giants in Saul's life he would now face would be the harsh opposition he would receive from the very people that he persecuted and who he wanted to befriend. Okay, he too was doing that in the name of the Lord. Now, the book of Acts gives a historical look at Paul's life and times. The Apostle Paul spent the rest of his life proclaiming the risen Christ Jesus throughout the Roman world, often at great personal peril. As I mentioned to you at the beginning of this broadcast, some of the things that happened to him. He was shipwrecked and imprisoned and what have you. There was another giant in his life. This was a giant in his life, as it is for a lot of us. Saul turned from his wicked ways after having one encounter with Jesus and now served Jesus just as diligently as he previously persecuted him. People are going to hate you when you follow after Jesus. They're going to, you know, want to crucify you, and they're You know, and when you no longer want to go to the club or go to the party and hang out all night long, or when you don't want to get drunk or, you know, do what you used to do, you know, then now these giants, they want to crucify you. They want to get rid of you. Okay, and when they feel that they have gotten rid of you, or when they feel that they have, in fact, successfully crucified you, okay, now they feel that they can do what they want to do to you, okay, or to anyone else. But to their surprise, the power of the Lord worketh within us. The power that worketh within us is greater than the power that worketh in the world. Now, not only Saul living a Christian life now, he's also preaching the gospel and wrote parts of the Bible. That's just like a gangster coming back on the streets and telling the former colleagues that, you know, what they're doing wrong. And the former colleagues are now looking at you like you're crazy. You was out there selling drugs before you got sent up to the big house, and you was out here killing people. Now you got the nerve to come back here on the streets and tell us not to sell drugs, and you was the head, you was the leader, you was the head honcho. And the same colleagues now are going to try to kill that person who's coming back at them trying to tell them now what you're doing is wrong. Don't tell me what I'm doing is wrong. You was out here doing it yourself. They have to find out for themselves that what they were doing was wrong. You can't convince them that what they was wrong, because they still see you as a drug dealer. They still see you as a kingpin or whatever. Matter of fact, that's exactly what happened in a movie that was portrayed by Denzel Washington. I don't remember the name of it, but it was a true story, and it was about the guy who was Bumpy or something like that. It was a gangster movie, and it was about, he portrayed him, and the man was still alive at the time the movie was made. And however, he came back on the streets to try to tell them, you know, what you're doing is wrong, man. You know, and then they actually shot him. They tried to kill him, and he crippled him. You know, so this is, you know, what happens. You know, people, you know, you have to be very careful in terms of what you do. You can't change anybody, you know. You wouldn't have been changed if it hadn't have been for that instance or that circumstance that you had been through. Paul would not have been changed if it had not been for his encounter with Jesus, that he had met up with God. A lot of times we have to go through to get to the get to. Our giants will come at us in various forms. You know, situations, circumstances, places, things. And that was a quiet place that they had to put him in. You know, they had to put him in a quiet place, but to blind him, had to humble him. You know, put a thorn in his flesh, like I said before, in order to get a message across to him. You know, Jesus said to him, "Why are you persecuting me?" And he knew immediately who he was talking to. He recognized the voice immediately. He was probably shocked. He thought he was doing this in the name of the Lord. But now the name, the Lord is alive. And he says, "Why are you persecuting me? This is not what you should be doing. You're doing the wrong thing, you know. Now I want you to turn from your wicked ways, you know. Otherwise, you ain't going to never have sight, your sight again." You know, this is, I'm paraphrasing. But finally, you know, we learned that anyone can surrender completely to God. Paul was fully sold out for God. Now, this is what Paul says, okay, in Philippians 1, 12 to 14. Paul says, "I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard, and to all the rest of my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear." Okay, may the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Now, Paul was in prison when he wrote those words and still praising God. Okay, throughout his suffering, Paul knew what the outcome of his life would be by surrendering his life to God and trusting him for everything. Okay, he knew he was going to be persecuted. He knew he was going to go through the hell and high water. He knew he was going to have to deal with the stuff and the mess and the junk as he did. Okay, he was willing to go through that. Some people will call you a martyr. And, you know, somebody who does things knowing that you're going to get punished for it, knowing that you're going to, you know, suffer for it, but you do it anyway. But he was doing it in the name of the Lord. Okay, and he also says, "For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Philippians 1:12. Are you sold out for Christ? I am. It's difficult, but not impossible, my brothers and sisters, to be completely sold out for Jesus, especially when all the opposition we are facing with. You will face a lot of giants in your life, and so will I. But remember, giants do fall. And Jesus didn't think twice about the rewards, benefits that will be accomplished as a result of him being crucified on the cross. Okay, what would be accomplished as a result of his crucifixion? It had to happen. It was a necessary prerequisite to the next level. What will happen as a result of you staying faithful to God and not serving Satan? What will you benefit now by not going back to your sinful ways? Will any good come out of it? Okay, will you be sold out for God? What Paul went through on his way to meeting with Jesus was training grounds for what the rest of his life was going to be like. Okay, what led up to Saul's meeting on the road to Damascus as a prerequisite to how he lived the rest of his life. Okay, that's what happens when we meet up with our giants. When we meet up with our giants, that's a prerequisite to how the rest of our life is going to be ordained. You know, what, you know, God is using a series of events to help turn things around, you know, to get bring a message across to us, to try to, you know, help us. It's not to hurt us, it's to help us. It may seem like it is, and I want to testify to you soon about the incident that I've been going through that allowed me to win the battle in the war against the enemy. A couple of battles that I had, but the one, you know. Saul's meeting on the road was a prerequisite to how he's going to live the rest of his life. It was a God-ordained move. God allowed it to happen. Saul got blessed, and God is glorified. Okay? Now, Matthew 6:19-21 says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures in earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, okay, or destroy. This is the New King James Version. And where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor dust rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For there is treasure, for where your treasure is, your heart will also be. Now, I've been talking about some of my book here, Win the Battle in the War Against Your Giants, The Champion in You, okay? There's a champion in each one of us, whether you know it or not, you know. But when you look at the series of events, if you really try to look at it, try to take responsibility and realize that you have to forgive the enemy for what they've done. Otherwise, you won't be forgiven. You know, a lot of things that we do, we're doing a lot of things wrong. None of us are perfect. You know, we're humans. So, yeah, we're going to, you know, things are going to go wrong. You could sin in your heart and don't even know it. You think a thought, and that could be a sin. You know what I mean? But not once did Saul look back on, you know, what he had done wrong. He continued to move forward. What was in front of him was more important than what was behind him. Okay, he didn't dredge on the past like a lot of us do. And every time, believe it or not, my brothers and sisters, every time we go back in our mind to what happened to us yesterday, whether it was yesterday, whether it was last week, last month, last year, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, whatever, however long it was, every time you go back in your mind and you relive those instances that happened to you, those that persecution that you endured, that trauma, that trial and that tribulation, every time that you bring that to your mind, you are suffering all over again. You are bringing the pain in your heart, in your life. You are actually going through it up here. You're tormenting yourself with it. Okay? So what we have to realize is that we have to focus forward, look forward, like Saul did. He concentrated on his life, what was going to happen now in the future. He knew what he had to do, and he did it with diligence and zeal. Okay, the same way he persecuted Christians is the same way he went about serving God. He did it with his, you know, he was good at it. You know, he didn't hesitate to do it. He had beliefs about what he was doing, whether they were wrong or not. But when he started serving God, see, now if he had to turn from his wicked ways, he may not have ever had regained his sight again, and definitely he would not have been in a position to continue to persecute Christians. If, you know, God brings these series of events into our lives to help us, not to hurt us. And that's what happened with Saul, a perfect example of that. You know, God didn't blind Paul to hurt him. He blinded him so that he could help him, you know, help him see the light, so to speak, you know. God does these things again and again, and especially for Christians, and he works in us. You know, the power of him works in us, and a lot of people who are not Christians can't understand it. They just can't see, you know, what we see in the spiritual, because we have what I call a third eye, you know, that we can see in the natural, you know, a lot of things. Now, God's promises never fail. You know, when God promises that he's going to do something, he sticks with it. And I'll probably talk a little bit about that, but you know, God promises he never fail. You know, none of the promises in the Bible ever fail. And you know, Joshua 23:14 says, "Not one word has failed of all the good things that the Lord your God promised concerning you. All have come to pass for you. Not one of them have failed." Okay, and that's exactly what will happen. Not one of them fails. Even though we do wrong, we have to stop punishing ourselves for past hurts. Saul did not punish himself for things that he did wrong, even though he knew that he had done wrong. He didn't sit in sorrow and whatnot. At least it doesn't say so in the Bible. But I don't believe that he did. I think that he had a job to do, and he did it diligently and faithfully, and he went about his job serving God because he knew that that's what he had to do now. And he knew that he was doing that in the name of the Lord. When he realized that Jesus Christ wasn't dead, that God wasn't dead, he realized, oh, he's still alive. You know, he felt that what he was doing before by persecuting Christians, he was doing that in the name of the Lord. But now here it is, the Lord telling him firsthand, you are persecuting me. That is wrong. Okay? And now he's face to face with what he has to do now. He has to turn his life around, turn from his wicked ways, stop what he's doing, repent, ask for forgiveness, among other things, and just move forward. Now he has to serve God. And he faced many trials and tribulations. He was shipwrecked. He was, you know, martyred. And some have say, I've read in one book, it said theologians have said that he was hung upside down when he finally was killed, that he was hung upside down and his flesh was torn off his body. Okay, now I don't know if that's true or not, but, you know, his flesh was torn off and then he was killed. He, you know, died from the pain or whatever. But this, you know, this is something, you know, not everybody's going to go through that to the extreme. But you have to remember, what was he doing prior to that? He was persecuting Christians. Okay, so even after he changed from his wicked ways, after he became a devout Christian for God, and he served him diligently with his heart, he still had done wrong. So, you know, you say to yourself, well, why should I turn to God, you know, if I'm going to still encounter those same things that I was encountering if I didn't turn to him? Because now you're not going to go to hell. You know what? God does, sin does not go unpunished. It does not go unpunished forever. I can guarantee you that. So the same thing that you did to people before you were saved, just because you're saved now doesn't mean that you're not going to encounter those things. You have to be willing to face the trauma and the mess and the stuff and the junk alone, but knowing that what you're doing it is for a greater good, just like Jesus hung on the cross. And he knew that that was for a greater good also. He knew that by his being crucified on the cross was going to serve a greater purpose. And knowing that your life is now going to serve a greater purpose, that what you're doing is not a waste of time. You're not a mistake. Okay? God is using you for a greater good. And you are getting blessed and God is getting glorified. And I've been talking about my book, The Champion in You. Win the battle in the war against your giants. And I'd like to thank you for joining me today, and I ask you to join me next week right here on Time Warner Public Access TV, Channel 20. You can visit my YouTube addresses at sblack3001. You can also visit Highway to Heaven Church for my religious videos. And also you can visit Affordable Homes and Apartments for my real estate videos. You can visit Books Galore and More, and you can order any one of the books, including this one. And this one will be available in approximately 1 week. May 1st it will be available. Okay, you can get it from the online, or you can email me, you can hit me up on Facebook or YouTube or any one of the social media networks, or you can go to my website, affordablehomesandapartments.net, or booksgaloreandmore.com, and you can message me there. Okay, please be specific in your message and indicating what it is that you are requesting. And I'd like to thank you for joining me today. My name is Dr. Sylvia Black, and I'm also a licensed real estate broker with Affordable Homes and Apartments. Holla at a sister. Peace out.